Welcome everybody, you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we're going to clean and prep some nested JSON. This was sent to me by a viewer who needed a little bit of help. As always, feel free to hit me up on Twitter and Instagram, and if you'd like to help support the channel, there you go right here. Let's get into this. What you're gonna need to do is just import pandas and JSON. Let's take in our sample data here, where I'm extracting the last two columns because they're unnecessary. Notice that we're starting with 10 columns initially, and we will have 50 observations. Let's look at what we're exactly interested in here, which is the response column, which stores all of our relevant information that we need to parse. So let's snag that right now. And we're going to use the apply function. We're doing this to expand the JSON or nested dictionary objects that we have. From that one column that we have for response expands into four separate columns that we now need to parse. Let's think about something. We're going to use three specific functions today. The apply method on a series, allowing us to expand one column of dictionaries into multiple columns. We will use what's called explode, which uses lists such as this, flattens those out, and potentially creates multiple rows as well as your columns. And then we will use json.normalize to take that dictionary and expand it. I decided I wanted to drop our response column since we don't need that anymore, and we expanded it from this new dummy variable that we just had. Notice that we now have three more columns for our data. We now need these columns right here, these new columns here, to be expanded. So we're going to take JSON normalize. You're first going to convert this into a string, and you're orienting towards rows, and then you're using the JSON normalize function to actually expand everything out. And what you end up with, let's look at how many columns we have now. So we have 24 columns now after expanding. And when you expand, what happens is the outermost portion stays, then you get a dot notation going inside of the nesting. That's what's going on with this. And if you notice, we still have further nesting that we have to deal with using explode to take care of the list, and then further JSON normalized or the apply function on a series to take care of your JSON object. I want to clarify something. When you're doing all of this, please understand that you need to use on a case-by-case basis for your data these functions. When you view these videos, understand that they're tools to help you and guide you and give you ideas of how to solve. We further use the explode function, and we're going to notice something here, and I'm going to show you this with the index position or index column that was created. So we use the explode. This is a different way of using explode. You could use it directly by calling your data frame dot explode and then the column that you want to explode. I'm using this because we have multiple columns and resetting the index, and let me show you why. If we instead scroll down to, I think it's around this range, we're going to see something. You notice that these two original indexes were the same because when we did explode, it took away the list, but it created the new rows that I said. This particular person was expanded because they have multiple phones, okay? And this will come apparent later. We further use the JSON normalize, same as we did before, by plugging in our new data. And now you're going to see that we expand this all the way up to 101 rows. But we need to pay attention because there will be a lot of duplicates. These data came from a MongoDB database, from what I was told from the client. That's why there's a lot of duplicates. Therefore, since it came from multiple tables and MongoDB deals with unstructured data, we're going to need to parse through this and figure out what we should keep and what is relevant. We need to first take care of any column that has all null values. For instance, when we did the JSON normalize, the columns that it was working with on the outermost part all became nulls, or we may have had nulls potentially on the inside that we needed to extract and drop. After we do this, we notice that we end up with 95. So we had six columns that were pure nulls that were useless data. Those probably were coming from directly the outside portions of the JSON normalize. We still have further data that we need to process. We need to take care of all this nonsense for the column names and only take the last or the second to the last dot notation to have a clear picture of where these data came from, what they represent, and get rid of any extraneous names that are unnecessary. That's what we're doing in this step. iterating through all of the columns, and I'm splitting on the dot notation on the last one. I could have kept the last two, but I did it on the last one to illustrate something here. Then we're doing a list comprehension and taking the last entry for this and appending it to a new list and updating our data frame, which is here. Now we're going to have a lot of columns with the same name, but we have to identify how similar they are and which values to keep, because indeed these came from multiple tables from a database, but we don't need all of that for our analysis. So what I did was I decided, let's check what percentage of our data are actually duplicate columns. And it appears we have 12.6% out of 95 columns. We need to figure out how we should deal with this now. Let's look at these specific columns which have our duplicates and individually start looking at these. I decided to create a function to deal with this. Here's something interesting. For instance, the first name and the last name have multiple duplicate columns. The first name is duplicated three times, so I would assume this came from probably three tables, or it came from one or two tables and it just had highly nested data. The last name has two columns, and I did a comparison for the full name column. And what I want to do is try to figure out which one best describes the data and is more consistent. Doing so, I created a function allowing me to decide for each one of these duplicate columns, the data frame and the column that we're calling in for the function parameters, and iterating through this to get the location of the index for each column that has a duplicate by the specific name. This is relevant because if we're doing comparisons, we need to A, consider changing the names and renaming each duplicate column and running a function for that separately, which is highly suggested. Two, what I'm doing is taking these individual columns and we're going to do some comparisons, and you're going to see that next. I decided to form a function that looks at the percentage of duplicate matches to see if we have 100% matching of the two columns or if there's discrepancies. There's some problems with this function. I'm going to tell you why. We're going to first use from the collections counter that you need to import a list comprehension that's going to look at our columns and see if there's duplicates. That's what's going on with this. Then I needed to iterate through this, the length of the list, and said, okay, is this one item? Is it two items? Is it multiple items? For instance, we have two items here where we're doing a comparison against, where I wanted to append the actual column and then run my percentage check here and append that in to see if indeed both of the columns match 100% or they don't, such as this one below. And that's what's going on. I printed this off and it looks goofy, but it's incorrect. The first name has three columns, but for some reason, linking this up, it did not print the matching three columns that you would have seen above for the indexes. Then we have some letter zeros, such as the product code and the last and middle name that we now have to further investigate. I investigated all of them. Here we go. Starting with the dates, using the first function we had, we could create the index positions. Then we could look at the individual index positions. This one matches up to one, so we're good here for the dates. You can choose the 8 or 9 column. Either one, it doesn't matter. You still need to disregard one of these at the end. For the success rate, the index position of 13 and 27, they all match. We have the report order number. The same thing, you can use either of those, they match. But let's get a further clarification of the product code. This is kind of goofy. This is a weird kind of thing that we have to do further processing, since we have one, a list here, and two, we do have some discrepancy if you look at this particular number one row. So it says we only have 25% matching so far. To do that further clarification, what I decided to do is one, rename the columns using this renaming lambda function here, where we're popping each one of the names after each occurrence, basically, and changing the names. We only have two here. You would really suffice to do a larger function to encapsulate each one of the names, but this is just for illustrative purposes. But it can be expanded later. After we do some finagling and we explode the column, since the right column you saw had list values, we needed to flatten that into strings and now do a string to string comparison. And we still have a 64% comparison rate for each of those. Therefore, I would say you should take both of these columns just to be safe and let the client deal with this on their own. The date and time, you can keep either or, which is doing the same things that we did from the above stuff. The inquiry purpose, I'm not sure what the usage of this is, but these columns appear to be for internal purposes for this business or use case. And what it appears to be is they just have some kind of general codes that they put in here based on why somebody made an inquiry into their business, I suppose. I'm not sure if this is actually useful columns, but you can decide to use this or not. Just depends on you. We saw that the names above had quite a bit of duplicates. Here's all of the names put together, middle name, first name, full name, last name, everything. We need to do a comparison to see which first names and which last names or middle names should be used, if at all. First name, we'll do 3 comparisons, okay? It appears that in the end, we have 32 and 13 being our best ones. Let's look at this. When we evaluate these data, let's do this. We'll notice that it looks like some of the discrepancies here, for instance, this may be a first name and a last name confused. Some of these we have all uppercase letters. You could do further formatting to fix this, but I'm not because I already understand that we have a first name and last name confusion here. So when we do the comparison, it looks like the 13. Let's look at something. Hold on. 17. So it looks like 17 and 32. Then we do likewise comparisons of the other two and understand that those do not match. And that's our best guess for first name. The middle name, it appears that you can choose the 39, which is going to be the second column for consistency. And let's look at that real quick. It looks like the middle name on the right hand side never matches up. Okay, so it appears that whoever is typing this in for wherever it came from, it just wasn't matching at all. So this is wrong too. So 37. Now for the last name. So we do a comparison with this and we'll notice the full name and the last name. Here's that problem that we had before with the confusion with the first and last name. Therefore, it looks like we should probably stick with this second column, which would be our 44, and remove the 37. Then for the names, you have to decide, do you want to keep first and last name, or do you want to keep full name, or keep all of them and do the comparison of which is best for first and last and append it onto the full name. That's what I did. I made a column for all the duplicates that we want to discard. These are the columns for each one of the ones we evaluated above, which were useless or not good for our comparisons percentage-wise. Therefore, now what do we do? We still have data that is in a position of needing to be cleaned further. I didn't do this because I don't know what the client needs, but I do understand that there's 2 particular columns for inquiry phone and PAN ID that needed to be further dealt with. Therefore, I created some functions so we can deal with this separately. What's going on with this? I decided to do a map function looking for any columns that had data that were a list. If they were, chuck it in. Then I take those and I convert it into a list and I call those specific columns and subset those. That's what's going on here. Then to get our final product stuff together, what do we do? I wanted to take these specific columns because this is relevant towards the final data that we're going to look at. This is a subset of it, but it's important from what I was told. This is what we need to evaluate next right here. A few things that I noticed. Why didn't I just use Explode and JSON normalize again right here? 1, I had issues and I keep getting an error and I'm not sure how to rectify it. That's why I went this route. It's telling me that there is some kind of duplicates. And I don't remember the specific error, but when you achieve it, unless you rectify what's going on above, you won't be able to move further. And the time I spent on this, I decided create a function and then deal with it. Here's what's going on with the function. If you want to pause it, I'm going to try to briefly describe it below. I didn't know what to name it, so I just called it FCN. You're taking in your 3 parameters, your data frame, your column, and then the list of your keys, which are inside of the column that you're evaluating. And when you're iterating through this, you're making a comparison to say, if it's not a list, then zip together your arguments for your list in the length of it and just apply none to it. That sounds kind of confusing, so let's step back. This is your keys that you're iterating inside of for the column that you're calling here. When you end up having nothing available, NaNs, NaNs, whatever, or NaNs, you need to replace it by something, or at least I chose to. And I chose to replace it by NaNs and append it as a dictionary. And I did that for both of these columns through this function. After we do our append for our list, I created a data frame, and then I ran the JSON normalize through it. So what this looks like now is the expanded form of our phones for the people relative to and how many phone numbers they have. The other one you'll see in a second. Now let's put everything together. We take what we did above. Now we need to subset these data and take out the person who has multiple phones and convert the two columns into one column for the phones and the other column relating to the primary and secondary phone labeled 1 and 2. So we need to subset and combine. I'm taking the columns, finding anything that has all NAs and dropping that. I'm subsetting the columns that I want specifically, where it's the person who has 1 or 2 phones and the columns of where they have their 1 or 2 phones. Running it through this function, and if it was a phone number, it's classified as a string. You append that as a list. Otherwise, you just append whatever came first, which would be either no phone number or any other indicator that they had within that. Convert both of those into a data frame. I want to show this just for privacy's sake. Now we need to take these data and convert them by dropping the duplicate columns and anything that's unnecessary. So here's the columns that we're moving from above where we did the comparisons to see percentage wise if the two columns matched or not. Remove the column that was useless, chucking that in here. Then I am concatenating, so I'm bringing all three data frames together for the two lists that we did above that were converted, and then now this portion that we subset out. I remove the phone numbers here for privacy's sake. And here's the information that we end up with. You see that from this, there were two people that had two different phone numbers that were evaluated that ended up expanding our data into more rows that we saw from above cases. We then put everything together into a final data frame format. So I just cut and paste what we did above, and from the subset where I dropped any useless columns, I threw that in here. I hope this brought utility to someone. Please understand that this video was to help illustrate some of the ideas and process that you need to consider when you're evaluating, cleaning, and parsing data. As always, I hope this brought utility to someone. Please like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, throw on that notification bell. Please help support this channel. Buy me a coffee. There's my handle. Have a good one. Bye.